Nobody knows what's around the corner. Life can be taken away on the turn of a sixpence. But as long as there are people who are prepared to come out of their door every morning and try and help other people, you have got to feel hope.
Hello, Queens. Oh, Jesus.
Adult and a tropical.
Been stabbed twice in the chest.
Fall from parachute, hard landing.
Collapse on a football pitch.
Charge to 360.
Excellent.
Thank you very much. Please call again.
Queen's Medical Centre, Nottingham.
Hey up, Ducker.
Another day in paradise.
One of the busiest A&E departments in Europe.
Wow!
That, I don't think, is survivable.
Have we got a new one coming in?
3 minutes.
There is no room at the inn.
Do you want anything to drink? Cup of tea?
This place is awesome.
A place where life...
Ding, ding.
You're a happy band of people here.
Love.
Love your kids.
And loss...
Top fruit and food.
..unfold every single day.
Working in A&E, you see people in those worst moments of their life.
My baby boy! I can't leave my baby boy.
But there are always stars in the black sky.
Oh, my darling.
It makes you realise how important life is, and we should hang on to that with both hands.
Have you?
Filmed across one 24-hour period, these are the stories of a nation and its health service.
Thank you for everything.
Oh.
Suddenly, a lot of the things that you thought mattered doesn't matter.
It's okay.
But you're there for me and I'm there for you. That's a strong bond.
I'm loving you too.
Bless you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
My name's Matt, I'm one of the doctors. How are you feeling?
There's a lot of difficulties working in A&E. You have a lot of quite visceral stuff coming through the door.
Motorcycle versus car, C-spine injury, apparently with distal neurology.
The ones that are bleeding or the ones that have lost limbs. There's a huge emotional toll. I do a lot of mental modelling to prepare.
Do you want something more for the pain? Yeah.
Getting ready for a shift, I'm asking myself the question, what is the worst thing that could happen today? And running through how to manage that in my mind.
Phone. Hello, Jesus. Yeah. Yeah, probably arterial, isn't it? Okay.
An 87-year-old woman is being rushed to Queen's Medical Centre after she fell on a moving tram and hit her head.
Head injuries can be tricky. If someone loses a lot of blood,
thank you,
then they will struggle to get blood flow to their head, to their other organs. And if we don't reverse that, unfortunately, they'll die.
Do you want a hand over?
Yes, please, yeah.
So, this lady, Joan, she's 87 years of age. She's been stood up on the tram.
Yeah.
The tram's pulled up and she's fallen backwards, hitting her occiput on the floor. She's got a really large hematoma on the back of her head.
Yeah.
A hematoma on the right side of her head.
Yeah.
And what looks to be a laceration also on the left side of her occiput as well.
Okay.
It's bled through probably 3 or 4 dressings that we've put on since picking her up.
Have you given her anything?
No, literally. We've just come in. I've had to hold her head all the way here.
Let's get some adrenaline and some lidocaine. Press quite hard on it for me.
Just hold on. Just going to sit down. And the tram went round. And then I was standing up and just felt straight up.
When we're assessing head injuries, there's a lot of things that we worry about.
I'm feeling funny.
Are you feeling funny?
Do you want to hook up so their blood pressure is machine and everything like that?
These patients can deteriorate quite quickly. Even if they look really well when they're coming in, even if they're talking to us and having a good chat, sometimes a few minutes later, they can be unresponsive and critically unwell. Are you okay?
Should we carry on with the pressure on the head? Is that all right? Give me that. Stick a pulse on.
Private monitoring, please.
Have you got something you can see?
No. It's just a massive egg. Press on that for me. Let me get some gloves on and we'll get proper access. Can I have a tourniquet? Can you get me a pink cannula, sir?
You gonna be sick, Joan? Vomit bowl, someone. All right. Joan? Hello, Joan.
Losing consciousness after a head injury is a red flag. And so we worry about injuries to the brain. We would need to get a CT as urgently as possible. So we'll get access, we'll get fluids, scan her head. I was going to just do everything now that we've had this, head to pelvis, just in case.
You're back again. How are you doing, Joan? Wake up, open your eyes for me, Joan.
Year-old Joan has been stabilised by doctors after she fell on a moving tram and hit her head. She's having a CT scan to assess the extent of her injuries.
Once you've stabilised the patient, we need to get a CT scan to have a look and see if there's been any damage.
They thought she was going to rest, didn't they?
I was just holding her, like, gauze on her head. And then she kind of just went a bit funny.
The CT will give us really good, clear information about whether there's been any fractures to the skull, whether there's been any bleeding in the brain, whether there's been any bruising, whether there's been any swelling. And this will give us a good idea of where we need to go with the management of these patients.
You all right?
Yeah. We'll get through it.
Yeah, we'll get you patched up and hopefully home today then.
Thank you.
Yeah. Have you ever had an ECG before? It's just stickers.
Oh.
And it picks up the electricity in your heart.
Yes, I think
it doesn't hurt.
No, I think I have had one. Yeah. I was born in a very old part of Nottingham. We had like an outdoor wash house. I can remember running over there and trying to turn the mangle.
Jane, have you got earrings in?
Yeah.
I've got the earrings.
Yeah, we need to take all your earrings out and your necklace off. Is that okay?
Yes.
Yeah.
That's got my daughter's photo in it.
Does it?
Yeah. Hope it's not ruined yet. My mother wasn't loving, certainly not to me. And so, with both of my children, I tried to be loving towards them. I think it succeeded.
Gonna pop some stickers on you, okay?
Yeah. My son was born not quite 10 months after Joe and I got married. I was very happy. The only trouble was I was praying for a boy and Joe was praying for a girl. But I got the boy. He got the girl second.
Feeling okay?
Yes, thank you. I was 28 when Lorna was born. She was the sort of baby, hardly ever cried. She loved horse riding. Most of my weekends were taken up with ferrying her here, there and everywhere and sitting watching all these horse competitions. She went to university in Chester, and then she was a PE teacher. She was apparently a very good teacher, and the pupils loved her.
Right, all done, well done.
Oh, thank you. Can I have a biscuit or something?
I'll see what I can find.
Yeah. Lorna came down one weekend, and when she got to the house, she said, "Dad, there's a new car in the drive." And he said, "Yes, it's yours. We bought you a car, now you can drive." And she was overjoyed. lovely. Thank you. On the Sunday, she said, I'm going to drive back to Chester. And we waved her off. And then she stopped and she got out. And she was waving to us and blowing kisses. And then she got back in the car and drove off to Chester. That was the last time we saw her properly. So cute.
Oh, these women looking at you.
It's yeah, the pony stopped, not a pony. Basically, what she's done is gone over its head.
I'm going to have a sneaky cuddle because you were adorable.
If it's any consolation, Kobe's team lost 7-2. He scored one of the goals, though.
Prince.
Okay. 13-year-old Prince is in A&E after injuring his leg playing football.
My name's Natalie, I'm one of the nurse practitioners on today. Are you mum?
Yes, I am.
That looks sore.
Yeah, it's terrible.
It was like a high-tempo game, end to end.
And what's your name, mum?
Sandra.
Within the first few minutes, there were some, like, rough challenges.
So we are a right ankle.
Usually, if I'm tackled, I usually just get back up, but I just couldn't this time.
Tell me all about it.
Came across, like, all of his studs went into my ankle.
Ouch.
Yeah. It, like, kind of bent to the right like
this. So your foot went like that?
Yeah.
OK. Whoa. And you fell to the floor?
Yeah.
Have you walked on it at all?
Yeah.
No. Have you seen your pictures?
No.
So the person tackling you has definitely broken it. We need to get the bone doctors to look at this.
Wow, is it that serious?
Yeah. I'm going to pop you on a bed so we can elevate this leg because it's even more swollen than it was when you first came in, isn't it? OK?
OK.
Yep. Thanks. So the room next door is available.
OK.
When I'm stressed, I don't really tend to speak out about it. I'm kind of a quiet person.
Lift it that leg.
I don't like making a fuss about things.
Prince was a very content baby, a very happy child. Oh, he was cute. When I got on the bus or in the train, literally people would come to say, is that a he or a she? Because he looked like a girl. And to be fair, I started plaiting his hair into little bobs when he was younger. So most people thought he was a girl. It was very different the way Prince grew up from the way I grew up.
So, I've just spoken to the bone doctors. They want me to put a plaster on your leg from your toes up to here, and that's really for comfort more than anything else. It's not to fix it. They're going to come and talk to you about what the plan is next. Do you think you could lie on your belly?
I was born in the capital city of Ghana, in Accra. We lived in one of the very affluent places in Accra because my dad was a businessman. If you have money, Ghana is the best place on earth to live. The weather is lovely, the food is good, the people are nice, the beaches and everything.
Are you all right, buddy?
It's fine. I was very close to my dad. I was pretty much a daddy's girl. He had a good job, he provided for us. Mum was a stay-home mum. Life was good. But then my dad passed when I was 5, and then suddenly, boom, everything changed.
You wiggle your toes for me. Well done. So the bone doctors will be in shortly.
OK.
Have you got any questions? Your mind's whirling, thinking he's never playing football again. OK, shout if you're in any more pain and don't sit there and bear it, OK?
Thank you.
Thank you.
I like a documentary, a bit of forensics. I'd make a great murderer because I watch all these programs.
So, if you need to bring anybody,
yeah, I'd be brill. Because I'd be I'm forensically very aware.
Hello. Hello, it's Christine. I am. Okay. Okay, that's lovely. Thanks for letting us know. Thanks. Bye. So there's been an incident on Lenton Road where a car's mounted a pavement and hit into some pedestrians. Boy just wants us to be aware that there might be a lot of injured potentially coming in.
Fine.
So I'll ring nurse and child.
Yeah.
A 19-year-old woman is being rushed to Queen's Medical Centre after being hit by a car whilst waiting at a tram stop.
My husband and I were in Portugal and we were just relaxing by the swimming pool. Then my phone rang. It was probably the worst phone call anyone can ever get because it was a stranger on my daughter's phone telling me that Rose had been hit by a car. They said she was thrown 2 to 3 metres up and 2 to 3 metres over.
Green trauma call, please, to ED Resource.
It was just disbelief that it could happen, and I kept saying, she's on the pavement. How can she have been hit by a car? We were so far away, I had to get back.
Major trauma consultant Bob is on duty.
If somebody's been hit by a car and thrown in the air, then that tends to imply that there's been a significant amount of energy transferred to the patient.
Just going to two. You pop on a trauma mattress.
Depending on which part of the car has struck the patient, you're talking about potential for pelvic fractures, injuries to solid organs, liver, spleen, rib fractures, long bone fractures, head injury, any of which can be permanently life-changing.
So this is Rosie, 19-year-old female. Rosie was standing as a pedestrian at a tram stop. A vehicle travelling roughly 20 to 30 miles an hour has mounted the curb and struck her at the same time as a lamppost. She has been propelled forward from that frontal impact onto a hard floor. She's had a right-sided impact, striking head and down the side of her body. She has upper back, sort of lower C-spine pain, hence the reason for immobilisation plus the mechanism.
Right, Vicky, should we get her off the scoop and wrapped up in the mattress?
And then let's go to scan.
We're going
to
get you off this surfboard. I'm just going to hold your head gently, OK?
We're going to do it on cantering, OK? One, two.
Oh, my God. Oh,
just
my
be...
God, oh, my God.
All right, you're all right, you're doing fine, love.
Let's give her some morphine first.
Yeah.
The two worst things that can happen, you always think not the head, not the back. And this was both the head and the back. My worst fears that she would be paralysed for life.
So in a second, we're going to roll you towards your right-hand side and then slide you across onto the scanner. Ready, steady, roll. Sorry.
19-year-old Rose is having an urgent CT scan after she was hit by a car at around 30 miles an hour. Doctors are concerned she may have life-changing injuries to her head, neck and spine.
So we're going to do a whole scan on you today, Peter. OK. So we're going to start with your head and your neck. Just close nice and easy. Just keep nice and still.
Rose is my second child. I have 3 children. My eldest is a boy. I don't think I really minded, but I was really delighted to get a girl. She was born on my birthday, and it was a fantastic birthday present to get a girl.
Breathe in and hold your breath.
As a little girl, she was very mischievous. She spent a lot of time trying to run away just for fun. She used to join other families on the beach. She painted the dog pink once. She was a free spirit. You never quite knew how she'd react or respond to something, but it was usually with humour and great amusement. She laughed a lot. Life was fun.
It was a car
what
struck.
Car mounted the pavement, gone too fast around a corner, slipped on the rails, you know, the tram rails. She was leaning against a lamppost. There's a proper lamppost dent in the car.
Yeah, like this far deep.
It was the summer of 2010. Rose had just turned 8. It was the end of term, and the end of term is always quite busy. There's school plays and sports days and parties, and Rose seemed tired. She didn't seem as happy and bright. I remember on the Sunday finding her asleep on the sofa, and that never happened during the day. I don't know quite, maybe it is intuition. I looked at Rose and I thought, I'm going to take you to the doctors. The doctor asked, you know, had she been thirsty? And the answer was yes, particularly on the one occasion when I'd been painting a week or so before, and there was, the paint was out and a bottle of white spirit, and she came in from school and she picked up and she said, Mum, can I drink this? I'm really thirsty. And I said, no, Rose, put it down. What are you doing? The doctor did a blood test there and then, and I remember her face. It's that face of deep sympathy, and we were sent to the hospital.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Cheers.
On the way, I had to be so brave. I had this little girl sat beside me with a great smile and these big blue eyes, almost thinking it was exciting that, you know, the doctor had said something, we were off to hospital. I phoned my husband at work, and poor Steve, I hadn't shared any of my concerns, and I just said to him, you've got to come to Kingston Hospital now.
So, we have broken that collarbone, which you worked out for yourself. We won't set you free from this thing until we've had the detailed report on the decent screens. All right?
And as soon as that's back, we'll be able to sit you up.
OK.
Hello.
Hi,
dear. OK. I fell down the stairs last night. I could have been a trauma call.
What did you do?
I went downstairs to get some minstrels at midnight. I wanted a midnight feast. And my boyfriend always tells me off at, like, snacking in the night. I was on my way down and I slipped at the top slip and just, bam, went all the way down. He came running after me. He was like, were you going to get chocolate in the night? I was like, yep, I was.
Like, why is this serious? And I'm out for, like, 2 or 3 months.
Out from playing football?
No, just, like, can't go to school.
Well, you can go to school with crutches or something.
Prince has broken his leg in 3 places. After being tackled playing football.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi. Is it Prince?
Yes, it is.
Hi, Prince. My name is Mohammed. I'm one of the orthopaedic doctors. What have you been told so far?
It's broken.
It's broken. Yeah. Okay. So I'm just going to explain this to you and Mum together. If you imagine there's 2 bones on your leg, you broke this one about here, and it's slightly moved that way. Okay? But the biggest injury is this here. There's a break that went through there and up here. What we need to do is try and push it back in place. We can put you to sleep and do it in theatre, or we can give you strong painkillers and also the gas and air. That will control the pain and we'll just try and correct it. And then we'll put the cast back on.
Buddy? Do you want to go with that option? And then if it doesn't work, you go to theatre to go through a surgery?
OK.
Yeah?
Yeah? OK, good luck.
Thank you.
All right.
So this stuff is called gas and air. You need to give it a big suck, as if you're sucking a McDonald's milkshake. Big suck in.
That's
and
it.
And out.
And out. And again.
In. And out.
Well done.
I grew up in Ghana. I was only 5 when my dad passed. All of a sudden, everything comes crumbling down. Things began getting hard and hard by the day.
Big, deep breaths. Yeah.
We didn't have anything, and that was where the struggle, obviously, began. I think for Mom, it was a choice between staying and watching your kids go hungry or making a move
sacrificing for them to have the best of future.
Close your eyes and big deep breaths. Big deep breaths.
My mum left soon after, I think when I was about 6. She said she's going to see how she can make things better for us, and that's all I understood and that's all I knew, and I was left with my auntie.
It's okay, so.
Big deep breaths, keep going. Keep going.
I remember when we saw her off to the airport on the day she was leaving, it was tears and tears as if my dad had died all over again. Because she told us she didn't know when we were going to see her again.
All the way to your toes. Keep going, deep breath.
She came to the UK. She worked to send money. It must have been a really, really, really tough decision. I missed my mum. There was moments that I really wished that my mum was around.
Well done, Prince. Just let him keep taking
keep going.
That.
Keep going.
Go on.
Bye.
What language do they speak?
Americ. She's from Eritrea.
Oh, good luck with that.
Do they speak Arabic and Eritrea?
Eritreans mostly either speak Arabic or their native language.
Do you speak Arabic?
No. No. Yeah, I'm Muslim, but no, we don't all speak Arabic. It's really inconsiderate and inconvenient.
Isn't it?
Just... English isn't a global language anyway, Matt.
I chat in
London. Such a British thing. All speak really slowly.
I'm just going to tuck you back in, okay?
Thank you. That's okay, thanks.
Do you want water?
Yeah. Thank you.
Joan has a large open head wound after falling on a tram. Dr. Matthew has the results of her CT scan.
Hello.
Sorry, I'm completely deaf.
Your CT scans all look okay.
Oh, that's good news.
No significant injuries. All right.
That's good.
So the plan is we're going to stitch your head back up. Get you looking beautiful again, okay?
Thank you.
Right, you need to make you comfortable because I'm going to try and do a proper hair wash. What hairstyle would you like? Hair colouring? Cut and colour?
Oh no.
Should we have a cut and colour?
I think she's got a colour.
Number?
I'll just have ordinary.
You've got a red rinse at the moment, whether you wanted one or not, my love.
A red rinse?
Yep.
My daughter, Lorna, was a teacher near Chester, and there were three other young women teaching at another school close by. And because they could all drive, they used to take it in turns.
Right, let's just get these out.
That's you. Thank you. I've gone now, I can't hear anything. I'm completely deaf. One day, it was Janet's turn to drive. And of course, in those days, you didn't have to have seat belts, not in the back. And Lorna was sitting behind the driver. It was in April, and it was apparently a nice day. They were on the motorway, and Janet could see the car in the fast lane going at really quick speed, really fast. And he suddenly swerved into the back of them and he hit them with such force that Lorna was thrown straight through the windscreen and landed on the motorway.
Warm water, Joan.
Hey,
warm water.
Right. That's nice. I was working. And I just got in and my husband, Joe, was just putting the kettle on. And then my son, Alan, appeared. And he said, quick, get your stuff together. We've got to get to Chester. Lorna's been in an accident.
We need a light.
When we got to the hospital, it was dark.
Is that all right?
Yeah, I think we found it.
They took us up to the intensive care, and this priest was just coming out, and he said, I've just given your daughter the last rites. And I just looked at him and I said, I thought you only gave last rites to people when they're dying. And he just bowed his head.
I think if you put anaesthetic in and can declot it.
Yeah.
She was just lying there. I was just saying, please, you've got to make her better. And they kept saying, she's not going to survive. It was on Thursday evening. We were with her the whole of Friday and all of Friday night. And on Saturday, they called us in. And that was it.
And this young fella, when he went to court, it was fined £100.
Oh.
That was it.
Hi, sweetie Jess.
You've been through the scanner, is that right?
Yes, I have.
Okay, and we're just going to have a look at your right collarbone.
19-year-old Rose was hit by a car whilst waiting at a tram stop. Doctors suspect she has injured her back and shoulder.
So the camera's going to come over top, okay?
At the hospital, we were told Rose had diabetes. I didn't know anything about what it meant and what it meant for the rest of her life. And I think it's probably best I didn't, because it was upsetting enough.
And then you just need to stay nice and still like that.
Diabetes is where your pancreas stops producing insulin. And without insulin, your blood sugars become very thick with a lot of glucose in the blood. And this can become very dangerous and is life-threatening if left unchecked.
You're
okay, now you are. It felt surreal that you could look at Rose and she was so healthy and happy, yet we were told she had diabetes. And I thought, that's awful, I'm going to have to give her an injection every day. I had no idea I was going to have to give her 4 injections every day and 4 blood tests, 8 needles every day. We had to learn to inject her, and Rose hated it. She was held down physically by 2 male nurses because she wouldn't. She'd run away, she'd try and hide. She used to beg and plead and bargain with me, and then she said, could she just have one massive injection, just one massive one, and never have to have another? She'd anything to not have to do it. I think even then, I didn't realise it was going to be every day for life.
X-ray clavicle.
Doctors have the results of Rose's scans.
It's mid-shaft fracture. Yeah.
Right, how are you feeling?
Okay.
All your scans come back in terms of your neck,
yeah,
and your brain and your spine and your tummy has come back fine. Good. Yeah. So that's good news.
Yeah.
So we can try and sit you up and see how you get on.
Yeah.
How do you feel about that?
That'll be good.
Yeah.
This mother in the hospital bed next to us, she said, I've been sat here feeling really emotional because I was diagnosed at the same age. I was 8 years old. I've never let it stop me. She said, I've been to the Amazon River and I've injected through my wetsuit. I have done everything and I've lived my life.
It looks like you've not done any other damage.
I know, I'm so lucky. Yeah, it could have been so much worse.
Yes, it's harder, and yes, there are more things to consider, but you don't have to let it dictate your life. And I think I took real strength from that, and I determined that whatever happened and wherever Rosie went, I would never let this stop her doing anything she wanted to do.
With her parents in Portugal, Rose's uncle Simon has come to be with her.
Hey. Yes. Sorry, I'm actually been okay, but I've just been moved, so it's just hurting a lot. Okay. Thank you for coming.
Not at all. Just rest.
Let's just lift this up for me, lift this leg. That's it, so can you stand and just pop your bottom on there? Well done. Just swing your legs up.
Prince is having an x-ray to see if his broken leg has been realigned correctly.
OK, so can you turn your knee in slightly for me? That's it, lovely, that's fine.
So my mum left Ghana for the UK when I was 6 years old, and it wasn't until I was 16 that I saw her again. It was hard because I was still young, and obviously I would have loved to grow up knowing who she was and everything. And it's not like today that WhatsApp and telephone calls are easy to make.
Nice to still.
The things she would have wanted to say to us in person, she puts them on a cassette tape. On this cassette recording, she would be encouraging us to learn hard and that she was okay. I mean, some of the things she'd mention, you'd be imagining them in your head. If it's a winter cassette, you go, it's cold, the snow is. I'm like, what on earth is the snow? I have no idea what she's talking about. But she goes, it's really cold. I've got 3 jumpers on. I looked forward to getting a cassette.
Right, Prince, lovely, thank you.
I was 16 before I came here to join her. And my mum bought a suitcase for me. She put in some clothes, and I remember there was a grey skirt and top that she wanted me to wear when I was coming to her. She came to the Heathrow Airport with my uncle to pick me up. When I came out, she see this, you know, relief on her face and the laughter. I literally run and jumped into her house. And I was just too excited to have come and see Mum. It was everything.
Hi, Prince.
Hi.
Right, so the X-ray shows that the alignment is better, but I'm afraid it's not in a perfect position. So we will need to take him to theatre and do it again, but this time you'll be asleep, so you won't feel any pain. And we've got x-ray machines in theatre where we can check that it's definitely gone back into the position we want it to.
Right.
I understand why she had to do it. She wanted a better life for she and her kids. And so for her to even have the guts to take that risk, I commend her now because it all turned out good.
Prince, oh, yeah. I have a driver for you.
I wouldn't leave my child for any reason, but I'm comfortable saying that because I haven't been pushed into a position where I have to make that tough decision. I would have loved my mum to be with me every step of the way. Unfortunately, she wasn't. So in my mind, I'm thinking, can I make a difference in my son's life and be there for him the way I would have wanted to be there for?
No, we're just starting with the stitches now, Joan. Okay.
So that part should be straightforward now.
Yeah, bit's okay.
It's all straightforward. It was just the bleed.
There's just a little bit here, which I'll try to. Stop. I think if we just close it, it'll stop.
Yeah. I want a pair of socks, darling, so.
I'd love to see everyone don a pair of socks. Mm.
can see my daughter, Lorna, every single day in my mind. The one thing Joe said when she died, he just got hold of my hand and he said, we'll never know what she looks like when she's a middle-aged lady. To us, she'll always look like that. And that's how we must remember. That's how I do remember. Just a 23-year-old. She'll always be 23 to me.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
I feel the most fortunate person in the whole world to have a daughter like Lorna.
14, I'm surprised.
You couldn't ask for anyone more kind and thoughtful and loving than she was. And I was very blessed with having her.
Thank you ever so much for you. You've done brilliantly.
No.
Yes, you
if
have.
You could see your wound, you have done brilliantly. Absolutely amazing.
You've been fantastic, all of you. You know, the one good thing that's come out of today...
Yeah, got your head up, yeah.
I've got to meet all you lovely ladies.
Well, we've got to meet you.
Yes, well, that's... I'm sorry.
Oh. I'm sorry.
This is the nicest lady of the day. She's incredible. She's so good.
Oh,
feel like a different person.
So we were faced with that, which was a massive wound. So we've taken all the clots from inside.
Yeah.
And this is what it looks like now.
Oh, well.
You will not know the difference. When those stitches come out, you comb your hair back, you won't know the difference.
Joan, I'm going now.
Are you?
Yeah.
Oh, well, thank you for everything you've done. You've been fantastic.
No, you've been so lovely.
Well, it's been brilliant.
It's been a pleasure. All right.
Oh, let's have a squeeze. All right.
You have a good weekend. Thank you.
A&E is a really scary place for a lot of people. It's going to be one of the worst days of their life.
I really got into my hair. Thank you.
Being separated from your loved ones makes a huge impact on people's mental health. So having someone that they recognise, that they trust and that they love with them is really important.
Hey, Mum, you all right?
Yeah, we're on the plane now. How are you doing?
I'm okay, thank you. Still just in pain, but I'm okay.
So we're going to be landing at about 9, and you can come to wherever.
Okay. Yeah. Would it be all right if you maybe came to Nottingham, just because if I'm going to need to come back tomorrow?
We'll come up tonight, because I don't want you to be by yourself.
All right.
But I'll phone you when we land, yeah?
All right, I love you.
All right, I love you loads.
Bye.
Okay, bye.
Hello.
Hiya.
Rose, I've got some painkillers for you.
Oh, thank you.
Have you eaten something? Have you got your insulin?
Yeah, I've got an insulin pump, so...
All right, it's not the one you need to inject. No.
I'm very, very proud of Rose.
Now, I'll put the sling on.
Okay. She takes knockbacks and she gets back up every time. She's brave, she's resilient, and she's strong.
How are you doing?
I'm okay, thank you.
Oh, you've got your sling on. Try and keep walking. Try and keep mobilising. We'll let you go. Feel better.
Thanks.
All right. See you soon.
Thank you.
All right.
I'm feeling a lot better. I physically am pretty much absolutely there, and I just feel really lucky. I don't think I would have managed to get through it without my mum. My mum honestly means everything to me. I've never had someone who is as selfless as her in my life, and I don't think I'll ever have a relationship with anyone else, which is quite like it.
I'm looking forward to playing again, trying to come back better than I was before. My mum being with me in hospital, it was like kind of a spirit lifter that I wasn't going through this on my own. So someone by your side, you just feel a lot more safe and secure about anything that's happened.
It's not the same shape it used to be. But I've been on a tram 2 or 3 times since then. She was precious all her life, Lorna. I can more than remember the good times because there were so many of them. She'll always be with me.